Good morning, ladies.
Good morning.
Thank you for waiting. I am very pleased to announce 2014 is in here. I've got Davuluri. She'll come out. I have a few things to say to you, and then she'll answer your questions. We do have microphones that are here for you to ask us questions when she's finished with her remarks. So, Miss America 2014, Nina Davuluri.
Hi girls, thank you all for coming. I just wanted to start off with a few words, and then I wanted to open the floor to a question and answer session. But it's really my goal to really make this a really intimate discussion. We're all girls here, so please let's have an open and honest conversation. But I'll go ahead and start telling you a little bit about myself. I grew up in St. Joseph, Michigan, which is right around the corner. And I suppose my path was very different in my career choice and what I did with it. But I came from a household where I knew that I had to pay for half of my education. And my parents were generous enough to pay for the other half of my education, thankfully. And so that's really where I started competing in the Miss America organization. So I started off in the Miss America teen program, and that's meant to be a feeder into the Miss America system. I don't know if any of you are familiar with the teen program. Anyone? Hands? Bueller? Oh, cool. yeah, you guys get it. But so through that organization, I was a former Miss Michigan teen, and then went on to be first runner-up at Miss America teen, and through that I won $25,000 in scholarship money. And so with that money and with the help of my parents, I was able to graduate debt-free from the University of Michigan. And many people, yes, it was amazing. and many people don't realize is that becoming Miss America is something that I've been preparing for essentially my entire life. And that really started, I think, in high school, because I was really quiet and shy growing up in middle school, and it was very difficult for me to walk into a room and introduce myself and shake someone's hand, and I can't tell you how important those skills are to have in life and in your future. But high school was really kind of where I found myself. And I did that by really getting involved in possibly everything that I could. And so I really started, I was a member of the tennis team, I was a cheerleader, I was also in the color guard and marching band. I did Science Olympiad. I took as many AP classes as I could going into college because for me it was really important to always have, or I knew that I wanted to go to college, but also just to have a good education and be a well-rounded person, because that's essentially what Miss America is. She has to be talented, she has to be well-spoken, and she has to be educated. And that's what the program really preaches, and that's our mission. And if you've seen the Miss America crown, it's hiding somewhere in a box in the audience. But we have 4 points to the Miss America crown, and those 4 points stand for style. Oh, here we go.
Karen's my bodyguard.
but it's shiny and sparkly. But there's 4 points to the crown, and they all stand for something, and that's service, scholarship, style, and success. And those are really the 4 pillars of the Miss America organization. And so one of the things that I really wanted to stress to you is that it's okay to be smart. And one of the things I promote as Miss America is STEM education, science, technology, engineering, and math. And that was really difficult for me because it was something I struggled with in high school, in the sense that I somewhat felt a sense of pressure that being smart wasn't cool. And I knew that regardless of the jeans that I wore or the shirt that I was wearing or what brand it was, that the only thing that really mattered is what I learned and how I used it. And that's really how I got to the point where I am today. And that's really what came into play with the Miss America organization as well, because right now I'm in the process of applying to medical school. I've dreamed of being a doctor ever since I can remember, and I knew that I had to find another way to pay for my education because I really didn't have any funds for that as well. So through the Miss America organization, I won a total of $50,000 in scholarship money, and then when I was Miss New York, I won an additional $10,000. And many people ask me, well, how did you get involved? How did this happen? And I said, well, it really wasn't handed to me on a silver platter by any means. It was something that I really had to go out and seek for myself. And I really had to stay true to myself in that process because my parents were really always supportive, but they weren't necessarily encouraging. And so this was my dream and my goal and my achievement that I was really proud of and knew that it was something that I had wanted to do, so I went after it. And one of the things I always say is to really trust your instincts and your intuition because it will really guide you well. But that's my little two cents or spiel about who I am and a little bit of my background and story. But like I said, I really wanted this to be an opportunity for all of you to get to know me, for me to get to know you, and to ask any questions about anything that you want to talk about, school, education, boys.
Okay, so girls, you all wrote down some questions, and those have been forwarded to her, so she has seen the questions, but we don't have them listed out. So if you remember the questions that you wrote down, feel free to ask, or even if there weren't things you wrote down, feel free to ask, okay? So now's the time for you to just step up to one of these mics, ask your questions. I'll start with you.
Sure.
We'll get
them
all.
Yeah.
Okay, so some girls have had a lot of challenges growing up and obstacles to overcome, and already in high school, they've given up. And they don't see a bright future for themselves because of everything that has gone on. So what advice would you give them?
One of the things I experienced as Miss Syracuse was my local title. Every contestant in the Miss America organization is required to enter a local competition before you can even compete for your state competition. So my family was from Syracuse, so I won the title Miss Syracuse and then went on to become Miss New York. But I worked very closely with children in the YWCA. And their mission is eliminating racism, empowering women, which went really hand in hand with something that I wanted to promote as well as the Miss America organization. And so one of the things I did, I had a circle talk, I suppose, with young girls. They were between the ages, in middle school, probably between the ages of 10 to 13. And all of them had been somehow involved in juvenile detention centers. And one of the girls looked at me and asked me, can you become Miss America if you've committed a crime? And that was such a memorable moment for me because it just made me understand how relevant not only this organization is, but how relevant it is to have a positive role model in your life. And for me, I said to her, well, I couldn't lie to her. And so I said, what's important is that regardless of your circumstance, your background, where you come from, is that you have a second chance to pull yourself out of that. And you can only you can make that decision, and only you can pull yourself from that adversity. And I hope that that's a message that I can send to you, and to really find a mentor that you can look up to, a person that you can talk to, whether it be a friend, a teacher, an older person that you look up to, is to really find that circle of support that you can have.
So quick, yeah.
Do I have to step up there?
I can hear you.
This isn't very probing, but you said you took a lot of AP classes in your high school grade. How did you say so? Did you say such stress for you, or did you?
Yes. It was really difficult. Especially my freshman year, because I was immediately, not to toot my own horn, but I was a varsity tennis player my freshman year, so I made the varsity team. And I just remember being so overwhelmed because we had honors classes, and that was like the system that we went to AP classes. So I was taking all honors classes. I was also in the color guard at the same time and on the varsity tennis team. So it was really hard for me to balance that. And freshman year was quite a learning process in the sense that I really had to be disciplined and work hard. And I would have to say no to hanging out with friends sometimes on the weekends. And it's a hard decision to make, but ultimately I knew that if I wanted to get into the college I wanted to, and for me that was University of Michigan, I had to make those decisions and I had to make those choices from a young age, because I saw so many of my friends and my peers not understand the importance of that, and then come junior, senior year, they're trying to raise their GPA, and they may not have, when they could have done it sooner. So for me, consistency was really the key. And then once I got into the flow of things, it was a lot easier, but I also asked for a lot of help for my teachers, and I had friends that I made in those classes, and we studied together. So it was very much a team effort.
I think you're really pretty and awesome, and I was wondering, what do you think makes an individual beautiful?
Definitely, and I know this is cheesy, but it really comes from within, because I remember when I was in middle school, this person said to me, this guy said to me, oh my goodness, Nina Davuluri has a bigger mustache than my dad. And it's funny now, but then it was hurtful. And I always say to others, how do you want to be remembered? Because I will always, forever remember that person for that statement that he made. And he could have, you know, he could become president, and that's how I'm going to remember him. And so I would just be conscious of how you want to be remembered, because your words have a very powerful impact on others, and it can happen with one statement.
During the Miss America competition on TV, they show like all the amazing events you get to like go to and like experience. So I was wondering about those.
Yeah, so all the contestants, we're actually in Atlantic City for almost 2 weeks. And the first week is an entire week of really rehearsals in preparation for the competition. So we have rehearsals, but we also do really fun events. So we got to take a shopping trip to the mall there, and then we got to go on Steel Pier, which is a bunch of like carnival rides, and just had all these elaborate feasts of food and people like treating us like celebrities, which was a really wonderful experience. But what I really took away from it is really truly the sisterhood. And I was really skeptical going into Miss America, because I had spoken with other former Miss New Yorks and other former contestants, and they said, you really walk away with lifelong friends. And I said, well, you really only know them for 2 weeks, so how is that possible? But it's so true. When you spend 24/7 with these girls, and they're all girls who are very similar and motivated and driven in the same sense that I was. We were all in college or looking for higher education, graduate schools, putting ourselves through college, really, and working hard and understanding the importance of that. And not only that, but every contestant in the Miss America organization is required to have a personal platform. It can be anything, that any cause that you support or promote. And we have many things from eating disorder awareness to heart health to STEM education, and mine is celebrating diversity through cultural competency. And so to have just such a well-rounded group of girls was really amazing. So my three closest friends, and the truth is you're not friends with everyone. It's not like we all talk all the time, but I walked away with a really close group, and that was Miss Virginia, Miss Illinois, and Miss Arkansas. And we have a text group, and we tweet and Facebook, and it's really nice to have that sisterhood.
Thank you.
After you won, I noticed that you had lots of people, you were getting lots of hate, and there was lots of like racial slurs, and I was wondering, how did you deal with that?
Yeah, it was actually really difficult. It was something I really experienced when I won the title of Miss New York. And I knew that should I win the title of Miss America, it would probably happen on a much larger scale. And for me, when I was Miss New York, I was really shocked because these were educated people. I had people calling me a terrorist. I had people posting pictures on Instagram of someone in a headscarf, which is very different misconception and stereotype that I won't even get into. But so that was really difficult for me, because these were educated people who went to college, and these kind of statements and acts were really intolerable in my eyes. And the way I had to handle it was to take that opportunity to rise above that, because there's always someone who's going to say something about you, and it's for a number of different reasons. But that gave me the opportunity to be able to talk about my platform and how relevant and how timely it was to celebrate diversity, not only in our state, but our nation. And so when I experienced that as Miss America, I remember thinking when this was happening as Miss New York, I was talking to my family, my mom, and my sister, and I said, why is this happening? You know, like, I worked so hard for this, and that's true, I really did. And if that didn't happen, I wouldn't have been able to handle it as Miss America in the way that I was able to. And so everything really does happen for a reason, and there was a silver lining with that.
How did you overcome barriers as a minority? Oh my gosh. Well, it was something I had to do my entire life. I grew up in a very conservative Indian family, and I remember so many people would ask me, well, what does the red dot mean? Are you going to have an arranged marriage? Or do you worship cows? And a lot of these remarks weren't necessarily meant to be malicious, but they were simply due to the fact of ignorance. And so I really took that as an opportunity to welcome those questions, because I think there's a fine line between general curiosity and someone who's just trying to be outright malicious. And, you know, I could take a joke. My friends would be like, oh, Nina's house smells like curry. And I'm like, yeah, it kind of does. But there's definitely a line between that. So I always welcomed the questions and took that as opportunities to educate people. Another thing that I'm so proud of is my talent. And I started sharing my talent really when I was in high school. We had a variety show every year, and you better believe I was front and center, signed up to do my Bollywood dance because I was so proud of it. And I can't tell you how many people said, Nina, if you're really serious about winning Miss America, change your talent because Bollywood will never win. And for me, I knew that if I wanted to win Miss America, it had to be in my terms and in my way. And for me, my Indian culture was a huge part of who I was, and it was such an honor to be able to share that with others.
Okay, thank you.
Since you went to the University of Michigan, I was wondering what it takes to get in, and especially if you're out of state, and what the university itself is like.
Well, I can't touch on all of those because I applied, oh goodness, 6 years ago. So I'm sure it's definitely changed since then. I would definitely say, obviously, your SAT, ACT scores, your GPA, those are things that you can't get around because colleges, all colleges, look at those. The classes that you're taking. University of Michigan is a very competitive school, at least for me, it was competitive for me to get in. And so just focusing on those kind of things, but also being well-rounded, and I think you've probably heard that from many admissions advisors and things like that, but really having a wide array of extracurriculars, so it's not just focusing on one area. As far as my experience at University of Michigan, it was amazing. I really walked away. I had three really best friends from the university, and they came and supported me at Miss America, you know, 4 years later. And so it was a wonderful experience. I loved going to the big house, if anyone's been or watched a Michigan football game. It's a great, it's a wonderful college.
Thank you.
Hi. So, in a previous question you had, touched on role models and how to get through that in high school. I was wondering if you had one when you were in high school or even through college.
Yeah, I definitely did. My sister was one of my closest friends. Where she's older, we're only 18 months apart, and she definitely kind of paved the way. In terms of, I knew that I could always ask her a question, always go to her. Even now, there's often days when I have time for one phone call, and that phone call will be my sister. But outside of her, my role model currently is Mindy Kaling. I don't know if you guys watched The Mindy Project or The Office. I was so starstruck when I met her, but I think she's just broken so many barriers, and that was kind of, I really resonated with her in that sense. And I grew up also watching Miss America, and Miss America was always one of my role models in a weird sense, so it was really important to me to also be a part of the organization.
Thank you.
Hi, I wanted to know what motivated your interest in medicine and also what kind of doctor you wanted to be.
That was something I really struggled with because I felt a certain amount of pressure from my family to go into medicine. And I think a lot of people in the South Asian community might feel that way. But for me, it was actually when I went to college, I wasn't able to have the experience to make that decision on my own. And so I actually was able to travel to India and visit an orphanage there. And visiting an orphanage is very difficult in itself when you have that experience, but especially this one more so because it was an orphanage where children had mental and physical disabilities on top of that. And so I went there 2 years ago, 3 years now, excuse me, and I was there passing out food to the children, and I remember this little girl came up to me who couldn't have been more than 4 years old at the time and had offered me the roll of bread that I had given her. And it's one of those experiences and moments that I had in my life where I realized that my purpose here isn't necessarily about me, but it's about the service that I can do for others. And one of the ways for me to do that, sorry, I get emotional when I tell that story, but one of the ways for me to do that was to go into medicine and to give back and to serve. And that's why a part of the reason why I entered in the Miss America organization was that I get to be an ambassador for Children's Miracle Network hospitals and meet with kids who have serious life-threatening illnesses and sicknesses, and to brighten a small part of their day, because they don't know who I am or what I am, but all they know is that a princess has walked into the room for a day. And that in itself is very humbling.
Hello. Do you feel that being Miss America has made you a stronger person?
I've learned to have tough skin. Yes. Because, like I said, in anything that you do, you're always, someone is not happy with something or another, and people are always going to say something. So I've just learned to take that, take the positive energy and keep that for myself and let the negative go. What is Miss America? Well, many people think that Miss America is a swimsuit competition, and it's not. It's more than that. It's very much a scholarship program and a service program. So to get involved, you can log on to missamerica.org and check that out, but you have to enter a local competition. It's between the ages of 18 and 24, and like I said, you have to have a platform, a cause that is that's important to you. And we compete in five phases of competition. And what many people don't see is the private interview. So I had a private interview with a panel of seven judges, and they can ask you any question from your platform to service to what's going on in the world, current events, anything is fair game. So we have that, and that's our first phase. And then we have a talent competition, talent, onstage question, swimsuit, and evening gown. And so that's how you get involved, but there's a lot of behind the scenes things that go on, because I have been really involved in my community, so I was able to take that to the next level with the title that I had.
Hi. How do you respond to the accusations that the Miss America competition promotes sexism and the objectification of women?
Yeah, well, that was actually really hard for me because, like I said, I grew up in a really conservative family. And my mom, to this day, will say, Nina, don't post a picture of you in your swimsuit. And I said, well, Mom, have you Googled me? Because that's really all that pops up, usually, among many things. But I actually struggled with my weight and my health and fitness for a very long time. I lost almost 55 pounds in the course of 2 years. I struggled briefly with an eating disorder because of it. And it was very difficult for me to learn how to live that healthy lifestyle. And that's what I loved about the organization. Well, not necessarily love, but I don't think any of us really walked out and were like, we love our swimsuit competition, because it's not easy. And one of the things I liked that it promoted was a healthy lifestyle, because as difficult as it was to lose the weight, I was more proud of actually being able to keep it off. And to live that lifestyle and to be balanced, not only physically, but mentally, socially, emotionally, and spiritually, was something that I really learned through that process. And the other thing I wanted to touch on was that, yes, as I mentioned, many people, when they see Miss America, you guys saw that one night of competition, if any of you watched it on TV, and you see that one night, and we think that's it. But Miss America is really one in that interview room. And you have 10 minutes to sell yourself, and there are essentially 14,000 young women who competed for my job. And so you have to really be well-spoken and be able to relate to others and walk into a room from Capitol Hill meeting the president, literally, to coming here and working with children at hospitals. So you just have to be a well-rounded person, and that's what I hope to showcase this year.
You mentioned watching Miss America competitions on television, and I was wondering what initially inspired you to even begin the process of competing for the title?
Definitely the scholarship money. Like I said, I knew that I had to pay for my education, so that was a huge point. As well as, now I have essentially a microphone, but a megaphone really, to advocate for a cause that was I was so passionate about. Because for me, it wasn't only about becoming Miss America, this was something that I could put my name on, because my family didn't really understand the program, they didn't know what it was about, and they really kind of thought, in one sense, and medical school was the only way. And for me, this was something that I did on my own, that I found on my own, and that it gave me a sense of validity that I'd really never had before, because I could finally put my name on it.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Oh, did you have a question? Yeah.
After your term as Miss America, do you plan on still being an advocate for whatever you care about, for the children? Do you still plan on speaking about that, or are you going to focus on your medical school?
Absolutely. I actually won't be able to start medical school for 2 years after I finish, so I have a year to continue my advocacy, but it's really something that even former Miss Americas continue throughout their lifetime. Some of them have started their own nonprofit organization. A former Miss America was an advocate for AIDS awareness, and now she works for a nonprofit organization still promoting that. So we definitely, it's a huge part of who I am, and it's my message and my brand, and it's definitely something I would continue.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Do you still get nervous for doing some of the things that you have to do for Miss America? And if so, what messages do you tell yourself to get over those nerves?
Yes, I do get nervous because I think one of my goals as Miss America is to be attainable. And whenever I think I often feel more pressure to look a certain way, and that never changes. We all feel pressure to look a certain way, but especially more so now than ever, because everyone's kind of watching what I'm wearing or what I'm doing or what I'm saying. So I have to be really consciously aware and very in tune with how I portray myself. And it's not only myself in the public eye, it's also via social media. And I'm sure we can all relate to how difficult and annoying, but also fun, that social media can be. And just the messaging that I'm sending, I'm constantly filtering, well, how is this gonna look in 20 years? Or how will my family respond to this? Or how will peers respond to this? So I definitely get nervous all day, every day, because I don't wanna offend anyone, and I want to be that attainable role model and person and image. But it's a very difficult job, because I always say this in the sense that everyone wants to win Miss America, not everyone wants the job of Miss America. And those are two very different things, because it's a hard job. It really is. A lot of people think that it's, you know, glamour, glitz, and pretty gowns, and sparkly, shiny crown, and it is a lot more than that. And the day-to-day life of my job is exhausting. And that's not to say that it's not fun, because it's fun being Miss America. There are perks to it, but it's very much service-oriented.
Well, I know that you grew up in an Indian family with Indian rituals. Like, do you think that becoming Miss America, like, has changed anything? Because, like, you know, I'm also Indian, so, like, there's a lot of things that, like, your parents have expectations for you. Like, they think for your future life. Do you think, like, anything has changed?
I think the hardest thing for my parents growing up in an Indian family, I think, aside from the whole med school thing, aside from the swimsuit competition, was also just personally, it was very difficult for them to understand what I was experiencing throughout high school and middle school, because they never grew up in this country, and they didn't understand what, you know, what prom was, what homecoming was, what a boyfriend was. And for me to, I'm 24 years old, and I know that seems old, but it's not. And I think the hardest thing was the concept and idea of dating, because my parents had an arranged marriage, and I've been dating this gentleman. Yes, I have a boyfriend. I've been dating this guy for about 2 years now, and sadly, I wasn't able to tell my parents until about 6 months ago, and that was really difficult for me, because I really wish that I had spoken to them sooner or approached them sooner and just said, you know what, hey, this is a person I really like to spend time with, and I'd like to for you to get to know him in the way that I know him, and just had an open and honest conversation with them. them. And it really wasn't easy when I started this conversation with them, but our relationship is so much stronger because of it. And there are still times when, you know, it's not always easy, it's not going to always be easy, but I think when you approach them in that kind of sense, and your parents at the end of the day want you to be happy and they want what's best for you, so you'll be surprised that sometimes they'll actually listen.
Sometimes, like, when, like, you grow up, like, in your high school, and you change, like, your decisions, because, like, your parents have something different, but you want to do something, is it, like, really hard, like, to face, like, to tell your parents that something, like, they think that is right for you, but you think that something else is right for you?
Absolutely. It's really hard, because at the end of the day, we all respect our parents, and we understand that they worked very hard to get to bring us to where we are today, and we wouldn't be the people without their support and encouragement and financially as well, we all know that. But it was really hard, and Miss America was one of those decisions that I had to make because my parents weren't necessarily encouraging of it. They didn't understand the program, and this was something that I really had to, again, trust my intuition and really, I suppose, put my foot down. I don't like saying it, but I always would have wondered what if I didn't do it, and I couldn't live with that feeling personally. So to even just say, you know, I told them and I said, this is what I'm doing, you can either be a part of it or we cannot talk about it. And I'm not saying that that's the best way to handle it, but in that kind of sense where I really think honesty goes a long way.
Where do you see yourself 10 years from now?
Oh my goodness. Well, ideally, I'd probably just be finishing up my residency. I would have graduated medical school, which is 4 years, and then a residency is another 4 years, so that's 8 years right there. So hopefully working, definitely continuing my work with the organization, promoting my platform and diversity. Hopefully being a motivational speaker. Lots of doors have been open, so we'll see. I'm not ruling out any options.
Earlier you said how you were like shy before. How did you like conquer that?
Oh my gosh. Yeah, I was really shy. I was always the quiet girl in school, and I'm still a quiet person, and that's okay. That's not a bad quality trait to have by any means. But I think the difference is I was still able to communicate effectively with people. And that was really because of my parents, and they really pushed me to little small things, as simple as like when we were at a restaurant, they would always make me order my food or always make me, you know, talk to the server or things like that. Just really small things where I was aware of communication with people. And another way that I really learned it was when I was a teen in the Miss America program. And I don't even know how would I have functioned in society if I didn't have that experience, in the sense that I am now able to walk into a room and shake anyone's hand and be comfortable doing that. Whereas before I would have been like, oh my goodness, there's so many people, like what do I do? So that definitely helped as well. But yeah, it's definitely a process, and just I would say working on communication is the most important.
What happens to the other Miss Americas once the Miss America passes the crown?
We're shunned aside. well, we all move on to do different things. So Miss America, it's really different for all of us because we can compete between the ages of 18 to 24. So there are some Miss Americas who have won when they were 18. And we actually had one when she was 17 and turned 18 like the following week, and that was our youngest Miss America, which is crazy. But so we all do different things. Some of them have went back to college or finished their degrees. We went on to graduate school. Vanessa Williams was a former Miss America. She's in entertainment now. Gretchen Carlson, she's on Fox News. So there's a former Miss America who's a physician, a lawyer, a Harvard grad, a politician. So we are really a well-rounded group of girls, and it's kind of surreal that I'm in this sorority, I suppose. But we continue to do good things.
Thank you.
question. I've noticed that around my school there are a lot of girls who don't embrace their race, and they try to fit to this idea of that white girl, not to be. But did you always embrace your race?
No, I didn't. I remember in high school I was really conflicted because I wanted so badly to fit in, and we all have that feeling and emotion and experience. And I get that, and it is difficult. And I remember some of my friends would say to me, oh my goodness, like you're like an Oreo, you're brown on the outside and white on the inside. And I was like so happy when they said that, because I was like, oh, thank God, they like me. And it was really sad to have that feeling, because like I said, my Indian culture was a huge part of who I was. And I think if my parents had also taken a more active role in helping me understand, sort of assimilating my culture as well would have been helpful. But also, it's really your peers that should also be educated. It has to really come from both sides. And that's my message, is that we're all different and we all have a different story and we all have a different background. But at the end of the day, we're all people. People are people. We have the same emotions, we have the same feelings. And all I can say again is that your words are so powerful. And regardless of your race, your socioeconomic status, your gender, that anyone can truly, I suppose, we can all find a way to communicate in an open and honest manner effectively without changing who you are.
You talk about how you feel like your thought process has changed from when you were 15 to now when you're 24.
I don't know if it has. I just remember I was walking outside and I said, gosh, when I was in high school, I thought I knew everything in the whole world. but I think really the biggest change is that I've thought more in depth about my future and not so much in the moment. And I think that's really hard, especially as high schoolers, is that we're faced with so many decisions about who we're hanging out with, who we're spending time with, who we're dating, what we're doing in that moment. And the reality of the situation is that those moments don't really matter in retrospect. And I've said this so many times because I wish someone had really told me that at the end of the day, when you graduate high school, what's going to matter is that you have your degree and that you're going on to higher education and you're going to college. And you have that career or goal in mind of what you want to do. Because for me, it wasn't, oh, I'm going to get through high school. That wasn't it. It was always thinking to the next level. Well, then college. Well, what's after college? What do I want to do in the future? Whether that be Miss America or med school or whatever it is to have that goal and set those high goals and constantly be thinking about how to achieve those goals. And if you're in a situation where you may want to do something, you really have to ask yourself, is this going to help me in my future or not? And make that decision in a conscious manner. Any other questions? You can ask me fun questions too.
Did you have any boy problems while you were in high school?
Oh my God, yes. Totally. And I think it was also stemmed from the fact that my parents just didn't really understand dating. But yeah, I went to prom and I went to homecoming, and I actually ran into one of my, this is really funny, but I'm from St. Joseph, Michigan. And I ran into a guy that went to my high school that I totally had a crush on. And I see him at this place that I'm at, and I'm like, oh my God, it's so good to see you. And then he was nervous. And we both just had this weird nervous moment where I was like, oh my God, I'm totally Miss America, and I shouldn't be stressing about this, but I'm like sweating right now because you're here and you're so cute.
Style and
my fashion icon. Oh my gosh. I really love
I don't know if you guys are gonna, should be watching this show, but I'm gonna say it, Mad Men. Are you familiar with it? Yeah. Okay. Well, I love that era and time period, and I think, like, I love the look of sexy but classy, and it's okay to be sexy, that's fine, it's not a taboo word, I promise, but there's a really classy way to do it, and just that time period and the sense of, I feel like this is kind of Mad Men right now, and I love rocking this look, but definitely from there, but also Natalie Portman, I love her style, it's very understated, but so elegant and glamorous, and I like that too.
You have a very nice complexion. Is there any specific way that you do your face makeup?
Well, there is. I had another really exciting moment when I was Miss New York, and so at Miss America, many people think that we have, like, these makeup artists and people who dress us and clothe us. No, you're on your own. You're literally in a tent. Like, this dressing room is, like, you're in a tent in a really small space, and you have one mirror, and that's about it to do everything. So before Miss America, I was actually able to work with Kim Kardashian's makeup artist. And we did like a 5-hour makeup lesson. He like came over to my place and we did a lesson and he kind of like taught me more things in terms of like my color shading, and that was the most difficult. So yeah, that's kind of where I learned things. So that was pretty cool.
Also, a couple people wanted to know, what kind of shampoo and conditioner do you use?
Okay. So my favorite are the Aveda products. I've been using them from high school, actually. I'm a creature of habit, but they're Damage Remedy shampoo and conditioner because I have really curly hair, actually, and it takes me forever to straighten. And then also there are face products too I really like for like just keeping clean. And that's the biggest tip I can give you, beauty advice, always take your makeup off before you go to bed. And I know we all get lazy, I definitely get lazy, but I always keep like the Neutrogena or those wipes, those makeup removing wipes on the side of my hotel room because I live out of hotel rooms now. And it's really convenient to just wipe your face and go to bed with a clean, happy face. It'll do you wonders. Do you have a question?
Do you plan on having children?
Yes, but don't tell my boyfriend that. At least not now.